Okay, let's talk about one of the central notion in machine learning, application of machine learning, is the notion of data space, and feature space. And let's discuss what does it mean and how it's defined. So what, I mean, in this course, we will use quite definite notion of the data. So for us, the data will be in a table with numbers. And this is the object with which we are going to work. And more precisely, even, I mean, there are different types of tables. So this table with numbers, it contains, it represents objects as or observations as rows of this table, and variables or features of this object as columns of this table. Together with table, you might have some additional information, which is sometimes called metadata. It's additional annotation of objects, their names of their classes or their labels, in other words, or maybe some numerical information, but that you don't want to include in the to the data space for some reasons. And also, you might have some variable annotations, because your observations might be also grouped into some accordingly to some principle and so on and so on. But nevertheless, the main so we are going to just analyze and see on this table of numbers. And let's say the main approach that we are going to exploit is that this geometrical point of view on the data, because I think it's the most at least for unsupervised learning, this is one of the most constructive way of looking at this data. And basically, we are going to say that this table represents a set of points in a multidimensional data space. So each row of this table is represented as a vector in the space which dimension is n, when n is the number of columns in this table. So I mean, you read the values in this table as a components of multidimensional vector. And for example, this row might be these red points in the multidimensional space. This is important, this equivalence between the set of vectors in multidimensional space and the numerical table. It's important to understand and realize that this kind of equivalence between two notions. So we mentioned this problem of large p, small n. And actually, I mean, from this geometrical point of view, it translates into the shape of data table. So when we have number of features is much bigger than the number of objects, so the shape of the table is very wide table with much more columns than rows. And in classical statistics, we have an opposite situation when you have much less, let's say, features than objects. But also, I mean, something that I try to express on this slide is that even if you have a white table, you can transpose it, you can kind of rotate it and exchange the meaning of features and objects. This is something that we do sometimes, and this is one of the trick which allows us to, let's say, switch from this postmodern, post-classical world to the classical situation when you have many objects. In some cases, it makes sense. So in terms of these notations, big data means when you have many objects to analyze. So big number of objects mean big data, and not big number of features necessarily. Wide data is when the number of features is much bigger than the number of objects. And let's say real world big data is most frequently follows these inequalities, is when the number of features is much bigger than the number of objects, and you have substantial number of objects. So this is a general characteristic of modern data sets. So of course, sometimes tables can be recorded, kind of collected directly, but many data types, they're not naturally expressed in the form of a table. So, you have to make some tricks to convert the raw data, the raw kind of initial representation of the data into the form of the tables. Nevertheless, in most cases, you do this transformation. So you start with some kind of data of some nature, and then you transform it into a numerical table. And then only after this, you can apply all this kitchen of machine learning methods. So for example, if you have a text, which is, of course, natural text, which is by far is a it's not a table of numbers. So how you do this exercise? There is, for example, this approach, which is called the bag of words, in which you count how many words at which frequencies occur into a text. And you want to use this information to classify, is it, this is a statement is about puppy or not, for example, just imagine the example. So, this bag of words already can be presented as a table. And for example, this sentence is converted to the following column. Of course, in the tables as we presented it, it should be raw. But what it says that you have a number of features, and for example, the word it appears two times in the sentence, so this is why you have two. The word cat doesn't appear in the sentence, so you have zero, and so on. And so you analyze this vector in order to produce your classification. Then, of course, if you have many sentences like this, you might form this table. You will observe, of course, is that you will have many zeros in this table, and you will probably need something which is called sparse vector representation. So there is a big chance that this table won't fit simply into your memory, and then in this case you will have to think about sparse representation. But these are all technical details. The same refers to the images. To some extent, images, it's not one-dimensional object anymore, it's two-dimensional object, but to some extent it also can be considered as a bag of visual words. And conceptually you apply the same approach, you count, the number of occurrences of these words, and then make this bag of words, and then make a very sparse table of occurrences of similar fragments into the image, and then you are able to perform a classification tasks. Sometimes the data is represented in the form of a graph, not a table, but a graph, and then the conversion of this graph into the form of a table or into the form of a set of vector in multidimensional space, which is really the same thing. It's done through a series of algorithms which are called graph embedding algorithms. Just to give you an example of the data which are naturally represented in the form of a graph, and this is the data which are used by recommendation systems. So in recommendation systems, basically you construct a very large graph in which you have several types of nodes. So typical types of nodes is consumers or users of some systems, and another type of nodes is items that these users act or select, say when they buy them and so on. So each user is connected to a number of items. So this forms a huge graph, and then there are different ways to represent this graph or embed this graph into multidimensional space. We are not going to talk about in details how it's done in practice, it's a separate field, and you can find some presentations from Jan LeCun devoted to this subject, quite advanced presentations, but just have in mind that nevertheless, even in this case, you first try to convert everything into a form of a table. Not all tables are numerical tables. And as a matter of fact, most of the data which exist in the real world do not represent numbers. So this means that you have to introduce a classification of types of data values that you can emit in a data table. So there is this general classification into numerical and categorical data types. So if you describe, for example, a person, as an example of numerical data type, numerical description, you can give example of weight or height of the person. And as an example of categorical, this categorical data type can be split into ordinal and nominal. So nominal is something which is frequently used. I mean, this is something that some values which do not have any particular order, like eye color, for example. There is no any order which you can naturally introduce and say that, let's say, black eyes are bigger than blue eyes, and which in turn bigger than green eyes. It doesn't make sense. Or mother tongue, I mean, the language in which a person talks, Russian, French, English, there is no particular order that you can introduce between these languages. If you can nevertheless introduce some order between the labels that which you describe the person. For example, you can assign to a person a label which would reflect its age. Like you can say that the person is an infant or a toddler, teenager, young adult, adult or senior person. So these are not numbers by themselves, but there is a particular order of these numbers. So in our field, for example, when we characterize a tumor, we frequently assign a stage of the tumor. And naturally, let's say you have stage one, stage two, stage three, which corresponds to the progression in the aggressivity of this tumor. So there is a natural order. Nevertheless, these are not numbers. So let's say it doesn't make sense to compute the distance between toddler and young adult. I mean, you can assign, of course, numbers 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but it doesn't mean that the distance that you would associate between toddler and young, which will be 2 in this case, is most meaningful, actually. So in this respect, the simplest type of data is binary data. It's just yes or no, false or true. As a matter of fact, binary can be classified as any of these data type. You can classify it as a numerical because it's 0, 1. You can say that it's an ordinal because 1 is bigger than 0 or 0 bigger than 1, but it doesn't really matter. Or you can consider it as nominal. You can say that it's just a label, false or true, or yes or no, and so on. So binary is a simple data type. So one important thing that you have to understand that even if you have numbers, usually it's these numbers, you cannot directly use them in the machine learning techniques. Even numerical values require some pre-processing and normalization, which is very important word in machine learning. The meaning of normalization is to make different features with which you characterize a person comparable. For example, it doesn't make sense to compare directly weight in kilograms and height in centimeters, because you could measure the height of the person in millimeters, and then it would be completely different scale. So the purpose of normalization is to put different measurements on a common scale, and there are some simplest way to do it. The most widespread way is so-called computing the Z-score, which really consists in subtracting the mean value and divide by the standard deviation. So this, in a way, we introduce a scale in which the standard deviation or variance of the distribution of the feature values equals to 1. Another usual way to make different features comparable is taking a logarithm from the data. And by itself, it kind of makes many measurements comparable, even if you measure height in millimeters and weight in kilograms after taking logarithms, these numbers wouldn't differ that much. The disadvantage of this approach is that, of course, you cannot take logarithm from negative numbers. So if some of your numbers are negative, it's not really applicable. So you might invent something else. It's important to have in mind that appropriate normalization depends on the initial distribution, and this makes very useful to construct histogram. When you have a table with numbers, the first thing that you do is you just plot histograms. This is very useful visualization. And let's say the final distribution after normalization can be also a hyperparameter in supervised learning. As a matter of fact, you can say that I would like to construct the normalized distribution in such a form which would be optimal for solving some of the supervised learning tasks. This is quite advanced idea with algorithms which have objective to construct such distributions. So for ordinal data types, so those labels which can be ordered, the challenge is quantification of these labels. So you have to assign, for example, for each category, young, adult, senior, a certain number. And you, with this number, you replace this label in the table. The methods for ordinal quantification can be classified into univariate and multivariate methods. So one of the simple idea of univariate quantification of ordinal variables is to pretend that the ordinal variable value is just as a discretization of some simple distribution. In the simplest case, it's just a normal distribution. So let's say the trick that you use, first you construct a histograms, so you count how many times the label is happening. So you compute the frequency of each of the labels in the data table, such that they would sum up to unity. And then you use this frequencies to divide the area under the curve of a normal distribution into the corresponding proportional to the corresponding areas. So this is done through quite simple formula. We can talk later how to do it in practice. And then, for example, you can divide each of the part of the distribution. You can divide by the area under the surface in two equal parts, and then this will give you a position of a numerical value that you have to associate to a particular categorical ordinal value. So this is one of the simplest approach to normalizing and quantifying categorical ordinal value. But there are more advanced and more interesting approaches, like for example, you can say that I would like to maximize all correlations between quantified ordinal variables, such that the amount of correlation between them or with numerical variables would be maximum. So in this case, quantification of ordinal values becomes a machine learning tasks by itself. So once again, So to prepare the data for application of machine learning, you also need to apply some simpler machine learning tasks. And this is quite common situation. And again, if your data are categorical nominal, so there is no particular order of the values, the data must be converted to numbers. And one of the simplest way to do it is to apply so-called dummy encoding. And dummy encoding, the trick is very simple. That you take, for example, for eye color, you might have several values. So then you split the corresponding column in the table into as many columns as you have values for this particular nominal variable. And then each time you have a corresponding label, you put one at the corresponding place and zero at the rest of the columns. So really not sophisticated approach, but this is something that is used by default in most of Python packages. So this is a commonly used trick. But have in mind that this is not the only way to quantify categorical nominal values. There are other ways. For example, there is this categorical principal component analysis, which in principle can produce more intelligent quantification. So small conclusion on the existing data types is that quantification data is extremely important for all aspects of machine learning. And as a matter of fact, it's a hyperparameter, which is frequently forgotten that it's a hyperparameter, but it should be taken into account in the learning process very seriously from the very beginning. And quantification of data is tightly related to the definition of distance. And quantification of data by itself might require application of some simple machine learning approaches. So then let's say a word about the notion of data point cloud. So really, data point cloud is this representation of a data set in multidimensional space. Sometimes it's not that multidimensional. For example, these results of LIDAR analysis of the surrounding environment is three dimensions, is normal three dimensional space, which is nevertheless represented as a data point cloud. So, I mean, this is a famous example of a data point cloud, which corresponds to the so-called fashion MNIST data set, which is encoding of images of different fashion items into multidimensional space, just accordingly to their pixels. And this is a two-dimensional projection. What is important to understand in this picture is that we are not able to perceive the properties of multidimensional data point cloud directly. So we need some methods to project this multidimensional configuration of points into low-dimensional representation and operate or make conclusions in lower dimensional spaces. So this is a objective of dimensionality reduction, and this is something that we will study in this course.